Welcome to the second meeting of the... That would help, yeah, okay. Take two. Welcome to the second meeting of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee in session six, and our first meeting together as a committee in person. Our first item this morning is consideration of whether to take item four in private. Item four will be an opportunity for members of the committee to reflect on the evidence they've heard earlier in the meeting. Do members agree to take item four in private? Great. Our second agenda item is consideration of whether to take item five, consideration of the committee's work program and future consideration of its work program in private. Do members agree to take item five and future consideration of the committee's work program in private? Thank you. Agenda item three is an opportunity for the committee to take evidence to inform its understanding of what its key priorities should be for this session. It's also an opportunity for the committee to inform its pre-budgetary scrutiny. The committee will be taking evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy in virtually, and then evidence from the Accounts Commission. I'd like to begin by warmly welcoming the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy to the committee for this first time this session, and I'd like to welcome her officials, Andy Kinnard, Strategic Engagement and Planning Reform Coordinator, and Bill Stitt, Team Leader, Revenue and Capital, Local Government Finance. I would now like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make some opening remarks.
Well, thank you very much, convener, for inviting me to give evidence to the newly formed Local Government Housing and Planning Committee today. And I warmly welcome each and every member. And it's good to see the wealth of experience that members bring with them. Can I apologise for not being there in person? I'm really sorry to miss what would have been the first in-person appearance since COVID struck. Unfortunately, I was due to leave the Highlands last night and travel to Edinburgh, and within about half an hour of heading to depart, I got notice from a close family member that they had tested positive. So I'm now obliged to self-isolate. So sorry for not being with you in person. I nevertheless welcome the opportunity to discuss the range of issues falling within the committee's remit. And it is quite an impressive range of issues from local government, planning, community wealth building, recovery from COVID, and so on and so forth. And I look forward to hearing the views of the committee. I'd like to acknowledge the pivotal role that the committee will play during these critical times. And I look forward to building a constructive relationship with the committee as we continue with our work to control the virus, to protect the most vulnerable, and also ensure that we can recover as quickly and as efficiently as possible. I think that as we look ahead to this session of Parliament, we do need to combine efforts to deliver a bold and ambitious recovery to ensure that we tackle the levels of poverty within our society, to engineer a shift to higher value and fair work employment, and also to ensure that we deliver greater financial security for families. I'm sure the committee shares my vision to create an economy that delivers for families, that delivers for citizens, a society that thrives across economic, social, and environmental dimensions. I'm clear that government, and certainly I, cannot deliver that vision alone. So hopefully we'll be able to work across the committee and across the government's work to support the public, the private, and the third sectors as we deliver that vision and deliver the best recovery that we possibly can. And I look forward to answering the diverse range of questions that members might have today. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So yes, we do have a range of questions, and we really appreciate you coming, and also the confirming that we will work together over this session. And I'm looking forward to that work that we will be doing. So I'm going to begin with the first question. So I'm curious about the policy areas that are key to economic and community recovery.
Yes, so it's a really helpful opening question, because if I tackle this in two ways, the first is that we are mindful, and you will be as well as MSPs, that many people are still grappling with the immediate impact of COVID. You know, I've just outlined the fact that I'm self-isolating, other families are self-isolating, there will be financial implications of that. And so whilst we're looking at the long-term recovery, we can't lose sight of the fact that many families are grappling with the here and now. And I think the first answer, therefore, is to try and support families as far as possible, and to support the public, the private and the third sector organisations that are critical in this respect, deal with the immediate impacts of perhaps insecure employment, the immediate impacts of children's education born of the virus. But the second part of the answer, which I think is what you're alluding to, is how do we deal with long-term economic recovery? And it's been mentioned more times than I can count during the pandemic that we need to recover in a way that delivers for people. We can't just recover the status quo. We must go further in tackling the inequalities that have been exacerbated by the pandemic, as well as ensuring that we finally deliver the ways in which we were still grappling prior to the pandemic. So to name just a few areas where I think the committee has a direct interest, housing, ensuring that we have warm, safe, secure housing for families up and down the country. And that comes from our Housing 2040 commitment. It comes from the significant spend on affordable homes. The second thing is local government. Local government have been a key partner during the pandemic, and we need to make sure that local government is resourced with sufficient funding, but also the sufficient levers of control and influence when it comes to responding. And then the last one is just on planning. And I am referring to the three parts of the committee's name. But on planning, we have an opportunity when it comes to the fourth national planning framework, which is obviously a long-term plan looking to 2045, to ensure that we have the development and the infrastructure needed to support sustainable and inclusive growth. So I'll stop there at the risk of going on. But I think whilst we look long-term, we can't lose sight of the immediate challenges. And I think this committee, of all the committees in the Parliament, is one of the most essential when it comes to actually supporting and delivering for families and communities.
Thank you. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I've got a couple of supplementaries on that. Just to kind of like really frame it around the role that local government has played in recovery, from your perspective, what do you see them having done specifically? And whether local authorities have enough money to support communities through this time of recovery?
I don't think we would have been able to get through the pandemic without local government and local government employees. As the person who was overseeing the financial packages of support over the last 18 months, I cannot pay greater tribute to the local government staff and employees, many of whom sacrificed weekends, evenings, holidays, week after week, to get money out to families and to businesses in need. And their names may never be mentioned in this committee or in Parliament, but they have been absolutely instrumental, and many of them doing it from home in quite trying circumstances. So local government has been the means of distributing support directly to people in need, and we couldn't have done it without them. In terms of the financial requirements of local government, obviously, every budget, deal with the funding that is given to me, and cut that funding in a way that tries to protect every part of our funding needs. So local government, for example, has been largely protected, despite the fact that we have been dealing with very difficult financial circumstances over the last 10 years. And I don't shy away from saying that these financial circumstances have been difficult. They are probably going to get harder in light of the fact that, as we look ahead, the outlook for our own financial settlement is quite challenging. We obviously, over the last year, had substantial additional COVID consequentials. They are largely now all spent. And as we look ahead to the UK government's budget and spending review, my impression is that the UK government will be tightening up quite considerably to deal with the implications of the increase in borrowing. So I think that the Scottish government's financial package, as it were, funding package, is going to be very challenging in this upcoming budget. And our responsibility will be to try and protect the health budget, protect local government, but also to try and remobilise. We need to remobilise our health service, remobilise our justice service, and so that the needs considerably outstrip the requirements or the supply of funding, if that makes sense.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and for your confirmation of clearly what local authorities have been doing in recovery and the recognition of the need for support. I'd like to call on my colleague Megan Gallagher with another question.
Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Just before I get into my question this morning, I would like just to refer to my register of interests, as I am a councillor in North Lanarkshire. Cabinet Secretary, I would like to ask you a question in relation to ring fencing this morning, as ring fencing is an area of debate which regularly happens between the Scottish Government and local government, represented by COSLA. And I would like to ask whether there are any plans to reduce Scottish Government ring fencing of local government allocations over the next few years.
Thanks, Megan Gallagher, and a warm welcome to you. And it is great to, as I said at the beginning, to have that wealth of experience of the background of members. So look forward to you bringing that council experience to the chamber. In terms of ring fencing, it's something that I would like to see decrease further. It has substantially decreased over the last 14 years in particular. And whilst during COVID, there were unfortunately specific pots of money. I've already referred to, for example, the pots of money that went for businesses, went for households, went for education recovery. And the nature of the pandemic required us to distribute money in that fashion. And certainly opposition members in the chamber were holding me accountable for ensuring that those pots of money went to for the purposes that they were intended. But when it comes to the local government settlement, I was very clear that the bulk of the funding that we distributed was not ring-fenced. And actually, when it came to additional COVID consequentials, the last thing that I did before Parliament went into recess was to increase the local government funding by over £250 million. And that was very specifically not ring-fenced to allow local authorities to tailor that funding for the greatest needs in their local areas. So I agree with the premise of your question and also confirm that my goal is to try and provide maximum flexibility for local government. Having said that, there will still be some areas where presumably opposition parties and the government agree that, for example, there should be additional funding that is specifically for education, but that is the minority, and the majority of funding is not ring-fenced, so that local government can use its discretion for how that is spent.
Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I'm going to call on Paul McClellan for another question.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Can I also refer to my register of interests? I'm a local councillor on East Lothian Council. Cabinet Secretary, given the possibility of continued one-year UK government budgets, is there a way the Scottish Government could provide local government and the third sector with long-term budget certainty over the next parliamentary sessions, perhaps with indicative budgets?
thanks to Paul McLennan for that. And again, another former councillor with a wealth of experience. So it's wonderful to have you both in the Parliament and on this committee. And I look forward to working with you. In terms of the spending review, so last year, you will be aware that we had hoped, the UK government had announced that it would be starting a spending review last year. And perhaps for understandable reasons, that was delayed. We are really hoping that it will be delivered this autumn, but we wait and see what the UK government might do. Certainly the Chancellor has signalled his intent to publish a comprehensive multi-year spending review later this year. And the challenge for us is that because local government is such a substantial part of the Scottish Government's budget, over £11 billion every year, it's very difficult for us to provide that long-term security without having that long-term security ourselves. Right now, the way that the budget works for the Scottish Government is that whilst we are given funding and it's gratefully received, that funding can be revised up and it can be revised down. You can appreciate that if we then commit next year, for example, a particular amount of money for local government, the risk for us is that our own budget might be revised down, leaving a shortfall. And if local government has planned on the basis of that funding coming to them, then we're dealing with a gap. So that's the challenge for us. But we desperately want to provide that long-term security. We desperately want ourselves that long-term security to make long-term plans, which is something we've been unable to do because of that year-to-year budget. My sincere hope is that we'll get the spending review this autumn, which allows us to embark on our own spending review and therefore provide that multi-year certainty to local government. So until we have that security ourselves, it wouldn't be prudent to provide it because there's too many risks attached to actually being able to deliver on that funding amount that we might confirm. But we want to give it because I know local government themselves want to give that security, for example, to some of the third sector organisations that they support, who often appeal to local government for multi-year settlements. So it's a domino effect. My hope is that this autumn that might change.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that response around the multi-year funding and your intention to try to move more in that direction. I'd like to call on Eleanor Whittam with a question.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary and fellow members. I would also like everyone to be referred to my register of interest. I'm still a serving councillor at East Ayrshire Council. Cabinet Secretary, there's been a vast amount of work undertaken over the last few years between COSLA, the Scottish Government partners, towards creating a new fit-for-purpose fiscal framework, and indeed SIPFA are calling for a rules-based approach. Can I ask you, Cabinet Secretary, what do you think a functioning fiscal framework between both spheres of government could look like and whether this will actually be taken forward as part of the local governance review? Thank you.
Thanks, Elena Whittam, and at the risk of sounding like a broken record, welcome to you as well, another councillor with a wealth of experience. So I think this is going to be a great committee. In terms of the fiscal framework, it actually relates back to Megan Gallagher's question as well, because my view is that if we have a rules-based fiscal framework to support future funding settlements, then we can actually maximise the flexibility for local government. And in maximising flexibility, we then can enable local government, facilitate local government to use their discretion and to tailor both their financial support, but also their own agenda to their local communities. And we had obviously started that work prior to the pandemic. We've committed to undertaking that joint work with COSLA. Work was delayed during the pandemic, unfortunately, but we have recommenced those discussions to determine the scope of the work required. I'll tell you what I don't think a successful fiscal framework review is. It cannot be something that is imposed by the Scottish Government on local government. So it's really important for me that local government can bring forward their own proposals for consideration about what a successful fiscal framework would look like. Now, that could be, for example, in two stages. We could have a two-stage process with looking at, firstly, some tangible asks such as, to go back to Megan Gallagher's question, such as the approach to ring-fenced funding and how we consolidate funding for local government as part of the settlement. And then we could look, as part of a second phase, at the local governance review. You know, what wider fiscal powers for local government could we consider? And as part of the most recent cooperation agreement, we confirmed our interest in a citizens' assembly on the question of wider powers for local government. So that's just one suggestion. But to go back to my earlier point, success will be local government making their own proposals about what would work, rather than Scottish Government starting from a position of saying this is the rigid, inflexible framework that we think should be applied. I think we started to see a little bit of this during the pandemic. So obviously, I took a series of asks from local government, from COSLA to the Treasury, asks around flexibility. Treasury agreed to some of those, not all of those, and we were then able to implement them and provide those flexibilities for local government.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for your response. I'd like to call on Miles Briggs for a couple of questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and to your officials. And I feel I should maybe declare that I'm not a councillor after this morning's session. But can I ask a couple of questions to start off with? It's now a decade since the government accepted the Christie Commission recommendations to look towards a shift towards prevention. Now, notwithstanding COVID, I wondered if you could give some examples of where that's happened in practice.
Thank you very much, Miles Briggs, and it's good to have some company and not having been a former serving councillor on the committee this morning. So I think there's quite a number of examples. Just briefly, before I get to those examples, one of the points I frequently make on this point around preventative spend is how important it is for government to go hand in hand, as it were, with Parliament in doing this. Because every year, and we're going to get into this again in the next few months, every year, Parliament quite rightly scrutinises budget lines going down as well as budget lines going up. And the problem with preventative spend is that, as you will know from your years as health spokesperson, in order to get additional spend in one area, which is prevention, you've got to see often an equal and opposite decline in other spending areas. Now, I've been at this committee before, and previous members who would ask, for example, why don't you spend more on environmental measures and in order to reduce the health harms at a later point. Now, you will know, as well as I do, that if we reduced spending in acute areas of health and moved it into more parks, I'm not being facetious, but you understand what I'm saying, there would be a bit of an outcry. So I think when it comes to preventative spend, we have to do that. One example, I think, in that space would be what we've spent on active travel and the low emission zones. So those directly have an impact, as you will know, on lung health, to use one example. That is a spend in the transport line, so transport has got to accommodate that, but the benefits will be seen in the health budget. And we need to get into the spirit of scrutinising overall budgets, and it's perhaps an area that the committee could take up, because you have such a diverse range of subject areas. We have to get into the spirit of seeing what's happening in one budget versus another. So that would be one example. But I think another area where the committee might take an interest is things in community wealth building. So where we're investing in local economies, we're investing in community economic development, rather than perhaps big national economic development, knowing that when you invest in local communities and you're creating jobs on a local level, that inevitably has a bigger impact on, for example, the amount of spend on welfare support. So if we are spending on creating jobs, we are not spending on welfare support, because we know that the individual is earning sufficient sums of money to support them and their family. So there's two examples. There should be more. In order to get more, I think we need to take a more holistic approach to both me setting the budget, but also, secondly, and more importantly, budget scrutiny.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. One of the most pressing issues at this moment in time, though, is around pay settlements within local government. So I wanted to ask, specifically to go back to some of the ring-fence questions you've already faced this morning, where the Scottish Government's thinking is on that, and do you accept that the £188 million bill, the Scottish Government's provided £94 million of non-ring-fenced funding for councils in the agreement put forward. Do you accept that will mean councils have to make cuts or eating to their reserves?
No, but I would also say, let me take those two issues in turn, because I think it's important that I talk about local government pay, and then I'll go back to talking about flexibility and ring fencing. As the member will know, and I've said this repeatedly to COSLA, I've said it in public, and the First Minister has confirmed this to COSLA as well, that our budget has been fully deployed, and there is no additional funding available for additional spend. I am hugely grateful for the heroic efforts of all key workers, including local government, but matters of pay are a matter for local government itself, that is negotiated between the trade unions and COSLA through the Scottish Joint Committee. We're not a member of the Scottish Joint Committee. We've never taken part in pay negotiations, and I don't intend to do so now. So that point around managing budgets is a question for COSLA and for local government. But in terms of flexibility and the local government funding settlement, as I said a few moments ago, in last year's budget, I was very explicit and very clear that we were maximising the amount of non-ring-fenced funding for local government. And it's at the moment, it is the vast majority of that £11.7 billion that local government gets. That includes some capital in terms of £617 million, but the vast majority is for day-to-day services. And as I say, the vast majority is not ring-fenced. So there's a general uplift. The last thing I did before Parliament went into recess was to provide an extra £275 million of non-recurring funding, so for COVID-related matters, and that was not ring-fenced. So the vast majority is not ring-fenced, and it's for local government to make those decisions. And I guess the irony in your question, if I could just say the last point, is on one hand, there is a general ask for us to intervene in local government pay, and at the same time to provide maximum flexibility and discretion for local government. So I intend to provide that maximum local government discretion without getting involved in matters of pay and how local authorities spend their budget.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And finally, I wanted to ask a question with regards to the SNP Green Cooperation Agreement. That included a point towards council tax reform, and I wondered what your thinking was around that and how that will affect potentially the work of this committee, but also council tax reform being brought forward within this parliament.
Yeah, thanks for that. And you'll know that over the last 2 years, I had chaired a cross-party group looking at reform of council tax. And again, unfortunately, that had to be suspended due to COVID. So the commitment is to look at council tax more generally, hopefully to invite a citizens' assembly to consider reform of council tax. I think it probably needs to be seen in the wider context of local government flexibilities and taxation, but the commitment is to invite to do a review of council tax as part of a wider consideration of local government powers, fiscal powers. And it goes back to Elena Whittam's question around what a reform of the fiscal framework review would be, and I think we need to see council tax as part of that wider conversation.
Thank you. Thanks, Kavina.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to call on Eleanor Whittam with another question.
Thank you. And Cabinet Secretary, it actually touches on your comments earlier about community wealth building. So as you'll be aware, the Ayrshire Growth Deal included £3 million from the Scottish Government to directly support a regional community wealth building model. Can I ask yourself how the Scottish Government will support councils and other anchor organisations to take community wealth building approach and aid our COVID recovery with it and move to a wellbeing economy model with that?
Thank you. for the question. I think there's certainly a growing understanding. I don't think it's a universal understanding quite yet on the role of community wealth building. In some ways, we in Parliament or in the public sector start using these terms without necessarily explaining what they are to the wider public. So I think there's a growing sense of that. In terms of the importance within the Scottish Government, we have seconded part-time Neil McEnroy, who was previously the Chief Executive of the Centre for Local Economic Strategies, and he's now a strategic advisor to the Scottish Government. As we develop our programme on community wealth building, you'll know that there are five pilot areas right now where we have worked with local authorities to produce individual community wealth building action plans to reflect both their economic challenges, but where we think there are opportunities. Three of those plans have been published. There are still two in draft. And the five pilot areas are Clackmannanshire, South of Scotland, Western Isles, Tay Cities, Fife, and Glasgow City Region. You've already referenced the £3 million across the Ayrshire region. So I think there's lots of good examples. And the key with these pilots and also what's happening across the Ayrshire region is to take it best practice and then roll it out. So, you know, working with COSLA, working with Slade, working with the Improvement Service to try and use community wealth building as a vehicle to deliver more locally bespoke, unique, inclusive economic solutions, rather than me as the Economic Secretary coming in and saying this one size fits all. We blatantly know that is not the case. And I think it's good to see that bottom-up approach.
Thank you very much for that answer. And if I can just follow up a little bit on it. So as part of that £3 million and other pilot areas that you're referencing, there's some money there to support local government in terms of the creation of community wealth building officers, etc. So when we're looking to passport that across the country, you know, the learning of the best practice, etc., will there be support from the Scottish Government to make sure that all local authorities will be able to avail themselves of the creation of such posts within their services? Thank you.
Yes, there will be ongoing support. If I can be a little bit tongue-in-cheek here, I think this is one of the core questions for the committee, and I look forward to the committee's steer on this, because, again, going back to some of the questions on ring-fencing versus questions on maximising local authority discretion, we will certainly provide support, ongoing support, both financial support, but support in kind as we develop this in terms of helping to facilitate providing expertise and guidance. But when we're developing new strands of work, the big question for us and the big question for committees is whether you ring fence that or not for specific outcomes and specific purposes, including when it comes to community wealth building. And I think, you know, the role that this will play in our wider economic strategy is really important. I want there to be a very strong local dimension to our economic strategy, and that will require local authorities to think creatively about what their role is in helping develop these local economic strategies. So we will continue to provide that support, yes, and my encouragement to local authorities to keep doing what they're doing, which is to work with local communities to develop local bespoke economic strategies.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on colleague Willie Coffey with a question.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. As a member that's been here for a number of years, who's served on local government but no longer does, I'm perhaps delighted to be part of this committee once again and looking forward to this session ahead. I wonder, though, could I pick you up on a point you made earlier in your opening remarks? You were talking about the recovery process, and will no doubt be hoping that our local government colleagues drive us through much of this process. But you said something that was really quite interesting. We can't go back to the status quo, or we shouldn't think we're operating from the status quo. What did you mean by that? Could you expand a wee bit more on that for us, please? And how do you see local government leading the line in the recovery, particularly for our town centres?
Thanks for that. Well, what I meant by that is that for many families across Scotland, the status quo was pretty tough and pretty grim. So when it comes to recovery, I don't think we can be content to just go back to the way things were. I think we need to resolve some of these structural challenges in Scottish society and in the Scottish economy. So one example being that work needs to pay. You can't expect families to make ends meet in insecure employment. And that would be one example where the fact that there are so many children in poverty in working households should be an incentive, a huge incentive, not just to recover to the way things were, but to do things differently. Another example in the economic space, as you said, is town centres. So prior to the pandemic, we were already grappling with the way in which our town centres have changed. People shopping online, perhaps local town centres struggling to compete with some of the bigger urban centres. And that's only been exacerbated during the pandemic. So more people have started shopping online, more people are digitised, and our town centres are struggling more than they were, even with the big emphasis on shopping local. So those are two examples where to go back to the status quo is actually not an improvement. This should be an incentive to act. And your question around what role does local government play is so important, because what we saw during the pandemic, and if I take homelessness as a good example, what we saw during the pandemic is that the need to act was so urgent, it was an emergency, that we didn't get sucked into process and bureaucracy, we focused on outcomes. And to go back to Miles Briggs' question about preventative spend, to think about what our national performance framework is that COSLA and we are joint signatories of, the focus on outcomes rather than the focus on process is what we need to do to fix these issues. So rather than get bogged down in the process of ending homelessness, we just decided together to end homelessness and went and ensured that everybody had a home. And I think that's the approach we need to take to every problem, is rather than get focused and fixated on process, have the outcome in our minds and actually just deliver against that outcome. It's easier said than done, but there's no more excuses, because during COVID, we did focus on the outcome rather than on the process.
Thank you so much for that. We expect local government to be the recipients of the UK government's levelling up fund as part of this process, but we don't understand what the role the Scottish government has had in that, or will have in that, or indeed what this committee's role may be in scrutinising that. How does the Scottish Government see that process going forward, and what role and participation do we have in it?
Well, I'm quite concerned about the levelling up approach for two reasons. One, the complete lack of clarity. So if you as a member of the committee are not sure how it works, then it's doubly concerning that I, as somebody who is responsible for appropriate funding of infrastructure, local government services, don't have much, if any, clarity on how it will operate. And that is concerning because we have got to make decisions and we're trying to use our money as prudently as possible to make it go as far as possible. And I think the problem in my engagement with local authorities is that it feels like a complete lottery. So they're bidding for funding, and they don't know whether they will secure that funding. And if they've got to make decisions for the benefit of their communities, and yet it feels like a lottery going to get this money, that feels quite unfair. And it also is quite concerning in terms of the lack of clarity. And so just for absolute clarity, we've had no input to this fund, and we have no evidence how it will meet the needs of Scotland's people and Scotland's places. In terms of my second concern is that I've had no clarity that there won't be an impact on the Scottish budget. So with the increased use of the Internal Markets Bill, with the increased unionisation of spend, if I can use that phrase, i.e. the UK government leapfrogging the Scottish Government or leapfrogging normal processes, my concern is that that money's got to come from somewhere. So that money will then be taken from the Scottish Government's budget and used elsewhere. We saw that in last year's budget, where whilst at one hand the Chancellor was talking about an increased capital spend, on the other hand, the Scottish Government's capital was reduced by 5%. Now, that may sound like small fry, but that is the money that goes on schools, hospitals and public infrastructure. So those are my two concerns. On the one hand, there's no clarity for local government or for ourselves. And on the second hand, it might not actually be additional funding. It might be just redistributed via alternative means.
Thank you for that. And just briefly on that point there, the members were talking about flexibility versus ring fencing. Has there been a discussion about those themes, those topics within the levelling up agenda?
Yes and no. I think, you know, with the levelling up, obviously local government, local authorities are bidding for money with no clarity on whether they will receive it. And one of the core principles in COSLA's distribution methodology is fairness. In other words, when it comes to methodologies, whenever we announce packages of spend, their constant and understandable response to me is that that should be equally distributed across local government as per the methodology. Levelling up completely moves away from that. So it could be that one local authority gets substantial capital funding through the Levelling Up Fund to invest locally for reasons that are unknown to me right now, whereas other local authorities are left behind. So where then does the fairness inherent in COSLA's distribution methodology come in? Does that mean that the Scottish Government then should give more to those local authorities that haven't received through the Levelling Up Fund? Is that fair? Or should everybody get an equal amount and it's just up to the UK Government to decide who is a more worthy beneficiary of that additional funding or not? I mean, it completely undermines that concept of fair distribution of funding.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Willie. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to come back to Eleanor Whittam with a couple of questions.
Yeah, so now shifting gears a little bit to the planning system, and I would like to ask the Cabinet Secretary how regional planning issues have been accounted for in the development of the National Planning Framework 4, given that planning authorities have not yet had time to develop their full regional spatial strategies, and the pandemic has actually exacerbated that a little bit. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Elena. And I may actually ask Andy Kinnear to come in on that, just because it's a question about process and development. But right now, in terms of the National Planning Framework, as I said, it is long term. It is a national plan. Communities, in other words, how we create livable places, well-being economy, and better green places. So sustainability, places that can be invested in and places that can be inhabited. But if it's okay, I'll ask Andy if he can come in just to talk about the process and the role of local consultation and local government being able to feed in.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. In terms of the regional spatial strategies, and this is a new provision that's come through the 2019 Planning Act as a key element of feeding in both to the National Planning Framework, but also to local development plans produced by authorities. We have been working very closely with authorities right across Scotland who have clustered themselves into particular groups to produce what are indicative regional spatial strategies. There's been a lot of work done within all of those groups that have been feeding into the current drafting of National Planning Framework 4. So that work will be recognised and represented, and I'm sure you'll kind of see some recognition of that when you see the draft NPF 4 come to Parliament towards the end of the year.
Thank you very much for that answer. And can I just ask one other question on that? How can we ensure that the spatial strategies and the planning policies to be set out in the NPF 4 will actually help deliver on Scottish Government's emission reduction commitments?
Thanks. Perhaps if I answer that, and then Andy, if you want to bring in anything else, please do. But the climate emergency is the overarching priority for NPF 4. So it will include a fairly urgent and radical shift in our spatial plan and policies to meet our targets, and it will prioritise the reduction in emissions in a way that also responds to the nature crisis. So, for example, it will play a key role in integrating land use and transport. It will focus on place-based outcomes when it comes to the climate emergency. It will support green economic recovery. It will support promote nature-based solutions, and also apply the concept of 20-minute neighbourhoods. And all of these things are geared towards responding to the climate emergency. So there are key themes in it, but if you wanted sort of one overarching priority that brings everything in, it is responding to the climate emergency. And I think planning has such an important role to play, because we have a choice with every planning application. Do we improve the way that our communities live and work together, or do we hinder the way that they live and work together in a way that either increases emissions or reduces emissions? Andy, I don't know if you've got anything else that you wanted to add to that.
Probably just one small point to add is that what NPF4 will do that its predecessors haven't done is that it will come with an enhanced place within the planning system as a part of the statutory development plan that the 2019 Planning Act is adding that in there. So the kind of policies and the drivers behind NPF4 will have a stronger position in the decision making on planning applications in the future.
Thank you for those responses. And it's great to hear the importance of the climate emergency, you know, front and center in the national planning framework. One of the things that I've been hearing over the summer, and colleagues as well, is the challenges facing our local authority and national park planning department. So I've been keen to hear about the, how the Scottish Government intends to tackle the resourcing and workforce issues facing the departments.
In specific relation to planning?
Absolutely, yes. Planning departments, yes.
Yeah. Well, I think we will need to ensure that that planning departments and, as you say, national parks or local authorities have the resources they need to implement and deliver NPF4. And there will be a programme to ensure that we're engaging with local authorities to understand the needs for delivery and implementation, and then responding to those. So I don't think we can divorce the policy from the delivery of it. Planning is perhaps one of the most obvious policy areas that only works if it's actually delivered and implemented. And it's a very front-facing policy in terms of engaging with the public. So again, I don't know if Andy has anything else he wants to add specifically about the process, but it was just to put on record and to absolutely confirm that we will be engaging with and are already engaging with planning authorities to ensure implementation and delivery. Andy?
Yes, I wanted just on some specifics. We had sort of pre-pandemic, we had carried out a public consultation looking at sort of fees and performance of the planning system, very much with the intention to increase the fees, the application fees that are coming through to planning authorities, but also to implement the provisions in the 2019 Planning Act that will give authorities more discretion on what they may be able to charge for. And our intention had been to implement all of that by last summer. Obviously, the pandemic came along and we paused that work, which I know we had discussed and was understood by COSLA and other local government representatives in terms of what that might have meant by putting sort of greater financial pressures on business at that time when they were taking the hit early in the pandemic. So that work was paused. We do appreciate, though, that the pressures on local planning services are continuing and perhaps have been exacerbated since that time. We have just recently restarted the work towards the increase of planning fees and are working on the back of that previous consultation to produce a set of regulations that will bring that through shortly. Of course, we're doing that very much in consultation with the planning profession and with COSLA and Heads of Planning Scotland, and we're sort of taking further information from them as we go. This is something that's going to be discussed in a bit more detail in 2 weeks' time when the high-level group on planning performance gets back together. Now, that's a group that is co-chaired by the planning minister and by the COSLA planning spokesperson. They're meeting in the middle of September, just really to try and sort of finalise some of the thinking towards the regulations that will be needed to increase the planning fees. So we are looking to get that increased finance coming into planning services as soon as we can.
Thank you for that reassurance and encouragement. I think we've got time for one more question. Megan Gallagher.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'd like to actually ask about brownfield sites in particular, as it is an area that I've got an interest in, because it not only regenerates an area, but also helps protect our greenbelt land. And it's to ask the following, what the Scottish Government is doing to support the development of brownfield sites, including support for site remediation and land assembly where sites are in multiple ownership.
Thanks for that, Megan. I'm very happy to follow up with a little bit more detail, but this is an area of focus as part of the economic strategy. So you'll know about our derelict land fund, which was announced as part of this year's budget, to try and incentivise the use of brownfield sites and of derelict land when it comes to economic development and regeneration. So a good example of that, which I had the privilege of visiting last week, was at Ravenscraig, where there is a substantial investment being made by private and public sectors to regenerate an area that perhaps is emblematic of a really challenging period. That's the kind of thing we want to do. So my question is, how do you incentivise the use of those brownfield sites for the purposes of economic regeneration and economic development? If there's more that we can do, I'm always looking at things like what ways can we use our tax system? It's limited because it's really only a property tax that we have in terms of non-domestic rates. But how do we use that? And then what funding might be available to unlock the potential use of those sites? But I guess my offer is, one, if there's more information I can provide you with that's specific to your local circumstances, I'd be very happy to do that. And secondly, if you think we're missing things in terms of enabling the use of those brownfield sites, then I'd be very interested in hearing more, particularly in advance of setting this year's budget.
Thank you for that. And I'm actually going to slip in a supplementary question from Mark Griffin on local government pay.
Thanks, Kavina. If I could just bring it back to that subject. For me, there doesn't seem to be much of a tension between ring-fenced support or local discretion since COSLA, the local government leaders, trade union representatives have called for government intervention on this specific issue. But I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would understand the feelings of local government staff when they see public pay policy being disregarded to give NHS staff a welcome, more generous settlement, that previously government have intervened in negotiations with teaching staff, that the Cabinet Secretary would understand why local government staff are on the brink of industrial action, the impact that could have on our schools and public spaces that have already seen severe disruption, and asked the Scottish Government to reconsider providing additional support to local councils and to get involved in those negotiations to reach a conclusion that means local government staff feel as valued as the Cabinet Secretary set out in our opening statements, and we avoid some of the disruption to schooling and other things that we've seen for the past year and a half.
Thanks for the question, and absolutely take on board the points around valuing local government staff. I'm sure all of us have been engaging with some of these employees day in, day out when it comes to casework. I could not have done what has been done over the last 18 months in relation to financial support without local government staff, and they have been truly and absolutely heroic. When it comes to pay, there is a fundamental difference, though, because we are the direct employers when it comes to the NHS. So it makes sense for us to have a direct involvement there. When it comes to local government pay, historically, traditionally and currently, it's negotiated between the trade unions and COSLA through the Scottish Joint Committee. We're not a member of the Scottish Joint Committee. We've never taken part in these negotiations. And I've been crystal clear that I don't intend to change that now. We are not the direct employers. COSLA, local authorities, are the employers. Quite clearly, I'm meeting with COSLA regularly to discuss all manner of financial issues. The First Minister has also met with COSLA. And on each occasion, I've been explicitly clear that the budget is fully deployed. There is no additional funding. I am not sitting on central pots of funding. And right now, our biggest risk to the budget is the fact that without a guarantee that we had last year, our budget can go up and it can go down. It can be increased, but it also can decrease. So our budget is fully deployed. There is no additional financial support available, and it's for COSLA to negotiate the pay deal for local government staff, who I agree have been absolutely heroic during the pandemic.
Thank you for that response, Cabinet Secretary. And you've been giving such clear and succinct answers that we have a little bit more time. And actually, I'm going to go over to my colleague, Miles Briggs, with a short supplementary question.
Thank you very much, Convener. I know we've crammed a lot in this morning, but I wanted to ask specifically a question around what's turning out to be probably the government's flagship policy with regards to the National Care Service. When the consultation was published, COSLA President Alison Everson described it as an attack on localism. And I know there are concerns about what this will mean for local government budgets, potentially seeing them having 40% of their budget taken out of their control. I wondered what your view was on this and whether or not those concerns are founded and something you would make sure local government would be defended so that their budgets are not seeing more taken off them.
Thanks for the question. It's a really important question, and it's one I imagine we will return to over the next few months, particularly in relation to the budget. Every year, when it comes to budget negotiations and budget engagement with COSLA, as you will appreciate, care forms quite a key part, the care service forms quite a key part of my interactions with COSLA, and I don't imagine that will change. So I imagine they will, this year, as part of the budget, talk about the support that they need, the financial support they need to deliver that. There's a much bigger process of consultation, engagement. We've had the Feely report. That's not the end of the matter. There is still a process here for considering what is the optimum way of delivering care for the user, for our elderly residents, for those that need additional support. And my view in this is that, going back to an answer I gave to, I can't remember who it was, we can either focus on process or on outcomes. We have got to focus on outcomes for the person who requires care support. But to do that, we've got to bring everybody with us. So my engagement with COSLA will continue on the financial settlement. Absolutely committed to continuing to engage with COSLA on the financial settlement. There is a big process of work going on within the National Health Service too, led by Kevin Stewart. And the committee will need to have an input as well. The committee will need to be cited on this work, and the committee will need to give a view on that work. So I take on board the concerns that you flag. I heard them from Alison Everson at the time. I think all of us recognise after COVID, we need to improve the service that we provide holistically to the people that rely on that service. And my sincere hope is that we focus on the outcome of improvement and care rather than focus on process. But there's a lot of moving parts, and we all have a role and a duty to consider how we take everybody with us. This service has got to be local. You've got to have a local service. So localism needs to be at one of the centre building blocks of our national care service.
Thank you for that response. I'm sure we're glad to hear the emphasis on the local input for the National Care Service process. I'd like to thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and your officials for your very helpful evidence this morning. I think we've got a lot. We've covered a lot of areas, and I think it has given us a really good foundation for going forward in our committee work. And we look forward to working with you over the course of the session. I now briefly suspend this meeting.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I now briefly suspend this meeting before we move to our next panel of witnesses. We now move over to our second panel of witnesses this morning. We'll be hearing from the Accounts Commission, and I'd like to welcome Elma Murray, Interim Chair of the Accounts Commission, Anthony Clark, Interim Controller of Audit, Brian Howarth, Audit Director, Carol Calder, Interim Audit Director, and Blythe Deans, Audit Manager. And I would now like to invite Elma Murray to make some opening remarks.
Good morning, Convener and Committee. On behalf of the Accounts Commission, I welcome the opportunity to discuss with the Committee our recently published Local Government Overview reports. We publish two each year, and they provide a comprehensive view of what our audit work has found. One report covers the financial position, and the one that we sent to you for today was the 2019-20 position, and the other, the performance and challenges being addressed and faced by councils and IGBs. We've made findings which cover a range of themes looking at funding and governance, inequalities, communities and recovery and transformation, and I'll address my comments mainly through those four lenses. First of all, though, in the last 18 months, the world has changed with the COVID-19 pandemic. There's therefore a need for clearer focus on where and how we spend our public funds in Scotland and how we ensure we support and enable those who need it most. The pandemic has created a unique and challenging set of circumstances for local government and will have a profound impact on everyone's life in the years ahead. We've seen clearly that public services have adapted, in some cases transformed, and will certainly continue to change. The financial impact of the pandemic on our public services has also been extreme. Looking first at our communities, we have seen the strength and resilience of many communities highlighted as they have worked with public service partners, including the third sector, to provide invaluable support to those who need it most. Those local areas where partnership working was already strong and embedded were able to respond and react more quickly to the developing needs caused by COVID-19. In many cases, individuals and groups of individuals in our communities have been absolutely heroic, and their efforts over the period of the pandemic cannot be in vain. Our audit work over the past year has focused on local government's initial response to the pandemic, and we intend to move on to consider the impact and lessons learned in more detail in future reports as councils move towards recovery and renewal. This must recognise and build upon what has been achieved within Scotland's communities so far. The pandemic has laid bare, deepened and broadened existing inequalities such as health, work, income, housing and education across Scotland's communities, so that more people are affected, and for many it is more extreme. The intersectional nature of these inequalities is now better recognised, but has the greatest effect on the most vulnerable, minority groups and women. There remains a risk that the ongoing impact of the pandemic will have further negative consequences on inequalities in the months and years ahead. It's therefore crucial that in order to build forward better, Council's recovery and renewal plans are robust and reliable and include clear detail on how inequalities are to be tackled. The early signs are positive, and it is clear that councils are striving to achieve this. However, there is recognition that much work lies ahead. Pandemic restrictions and suppression measures such as lockdowns, social distancing and working from home have had a profound effect on key council services. Very few, if any, council services have been unaffected by the impact of the pandemic. Councils quickly pivoted to new digital delivery models, and we saw many examples of change and innovation, including staff flexibility, that were introduced that were previously considered not achievable or almost impossible. This new way of working needs to be harnessed and consolidated with lessons learned, shared and improved upon. It's also vital that councils do not default to previous ways of working in areas where new approaches are having positive outcomes. Recovery and transformation plans must be aligned and integrated, taking account of other critical areas such as climate change, net zero and supporting a green economy. Effective long-term financial planning is vital for councils as they transition from response to recovery and transformation. Councils have worked with reducing funding over a number of years, and face an increasingly challenging financial outlook with little financial certainty beyond the current financial year. Those councils with strong medium or long-term financial plans were in a stronger position to respond to the pandemic. The Accounts Commission has regularly reported on the importance of long-term financial planning for councils, and they need the certainty of a multi-year financial settlement to do this. Councils have experienced significant loss of income and additional costs as a result of COVID-19. This will undoubtedly have a consequential impact in the coming years. However, substantial additional funding to support council in their pandemic response was provided by the Scottish Government in 2020-21 and beyond, with total funding to local authorities and communities by April 2021 of over £2.2 billion. Further support will be needed to allow councils to take a comprehensive and holistic approach as they look to stimulate economic recovery, address inequalities and empower communities. Our reports set out that the context in which councils are operating is increasingly uncertain, complex and challenging, and the strain on budgets continues to intensify. It is likely that the scale and complexity of the challenges faced will continue to grow. Therefore, the role of senior officers and elected members in creating a strong culture of collaborative leadership is imperative. Our reports therefore emphasise the importance of strong leadership, effective governance and good financial management for all councils. This will help set the tone for the organisation and encourage effective and sustained partnership working alongside clear alignment between vision, strategic priorities and the delivery of crucial services as they look ahead to recovery and renewal. As the committee determines its priorities and work programme, I would be very happy to meet regularly with you to support you in your deliberations, both in public and, if you wish, in private. Finally, Convener, myself, the Controller of Audit and my Audit Scotland colleagues here today are very much looking forward to answering your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Elma, and thank you for laying out the perspective of the Accounts Commission. So in your opening remarks, you kind of took a broad stroke on various issues facing local government. I'm interested to hear from you, and I think as we've spoken before, I kind of need to see those highlights. So what are the biggest challenges you think are facing local government over this new parliamentary session? Okay, so we're going to suspend the meeting briefly because it seems to be a communication problem in our audio. I don't think Elma is hearing us. Oh, she is now. Okay, we're okay now. Okay, so I'm going to ask my question again. So in your opening remarks, you kind of outlined a range of areas that are challenges facing local government. I'd love to hear from you your perspective. What do you think the biggest challenges are facing local government in this coming parliamentary session?
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that convener. I'll maybe say a few words and then ask the Controller of Audit if he wants to say a few words as well. But for me, I think the first one is the fiscal framework within which local government works. It's increasingly difficult for them to plan ahead, and if they're unable to plan ahead, then they're unable to do the very best for the communities that they support. The second issue, I think, is how communities can tackle inequalities. What we've seen through the pandemic is that not new inequalities emerging, but the inequalities have got much worse. And they have both deepened in terms of how they affect people who were affected before the pandemic. And I heard the evidence from the Cabinet Secretary earlier, and she clearly recognises that. But also they have widened so that many, many more people are now impacted by those inequalities. Councils need the ability to look at those inequalities and how they're affecting people in a local dimension, because it will not be the same across Scotland, so they need that local flexibility to use their resources in different ways. I think the other issue for me for the Commission for local government will be for them not to return to the way things were. Again, as the Cabinet Secretary said earlier today, for a lot of people in Scotland, the way things were before the pandemic was not nearly good enough. So we can't go back, we need to go forward, and we now need to look at how we eradicate many of those, or reverse many of those inequalities that were in place, to try to give everybody in Scotland a much better quality of life. I'll pause there, convener, and invite our Controller of Audit, Anthony Clark, if he wants to add a few words to that.
Thank you very much, Elma. And good morning, committee. I'd agree with Elma that the fiscal framework is a really important issue moving forward, and the whole notion of local autonomy and the way in which local government works with central government will be key, I think, to taking forward effective progress again in the longer term against the COVID-19 pandemic. For me, the issue of inequality is fundamentally important, and I agree with Elma that has to be at the front and centre of how local government works with central government, the third sector and communities build back better. That will require strong leadership, collaborative leadership. And I think one of the risks around the next phase of the pandemic is people drifting back into old ways of working and focusing on their own services, be that the health service, police and fire, not focusing on how they can better work together to meet the needs of communities. I'd add one further thing to the list, which is digital. We've seen an amazing kind of way in which local government has pivoted across to digital service delivery. But when the Commission reported in January of this year on digital progress in local government, we were still highlighting, I think, some quite important digital leadership and capacity and skills in local government. So I think there will be issues in and around that. Finally, I think it's bringing this all together. We've heard the Cabinet Secretary talk today around the green economy and fairer work. I think there's still more work to do to actually clarify what exactly the new models of greener, fairer work will look like, and what role local government and their partners can play in that. So quite a lot to play for, but I'm optimistic. I think local government has done a fantastic job in the last 18 months. We should give credit to their staff and their colleagues. I think the issue of community involvement will be fundamentally important, as Elma said. If we can maintain that energy that we've seen unleashed through communities working with councils and the third sector, we'll be well placed for moving forward positively. But it is going to be hard. We're in this for the long haul.
Thank you both for your perspectives, and absolutely, yes, absolutely celebrating the work of local government and every single person who works there. I'd like to move to Eleanor Whittam with a question.
Thanks for that, convener, and good morning, Elma, and fellow members of the Commission. It's just touching on what you've already spoken about this morning. So we did see a huge shift in terms of focusing on outcomes as opposed to processes, and there's lots of lessons that we've learned over the last year and a half in local government. And, you know, local government has significantly changed practices and you know, responded and adapted very quickly. So I'm just wondering, you know, you just touched there, Anthony, on digital. So that's one example. But if you can maybe give us some more examples of how local government adapted and changed quickly, and whether or not we're going to see this spirit of innovation and partnership across local government and other partners and sectors continue as we go forward, so we're not slipping back into those old ways of working. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Whittam. It's lovely to see you here again today. We did work together when I was in North Ayrshire, so it's good to see you at the committee, and thank you for your question. I'll ask Anthony to come in just a moment, but one of the other areas where we have seen significant change during the pandemic was the speed with which councils moved to do things in a different way. Now, digital was one of those, and they were able to implement a whole range of digital and solutions, not just for staff to work at home, but also for communities to get access to services. But also the speed and flexibility within which staff pivoted themselves into providing different types of services. So we saw a whole raft of community hubs getting set up right across Scotland, where staff who had never been in that type of role providing support to local people in a very different way. Now, whether it was support for people who were shielding, so that might be medicines or food being delivered, or whether it was support for people who were really struggling to get by just on a day-to-day basis, they did lots and lots of different types of work. That wasn't just councils, that was also working with health partners, with the third sector, with volunteers from communities as well. And I would say again that volunteers from communities played an absolute blinder of a role during the worst of the initial phase of the pandemic and then through the second phase, second wave. Absolutely incredible efforts. And we need to recognise that that can't continue. They need to be congratulated for, but we need to put in place more support for them. But certainly those are some of the things that we have seen through our audit work. And our most recent report that was published in at the end of May actually highlights a whole range of examples across Scotland. And we took a lot of time to actually identify and find really lots of good practice that we could allow to be shared right across the country. Anthony, I don't know if there's anything you want to add to that as well.
Thanks, Elma. Not much to add to what you say, because I think you've captured very well the kind of main spread of the things that we've seen that have been innovative over the recent period. I would just say, though, I think one of the observations we have is that we've seen people ask themselves some quite searching questions around some kind of issues around governance and accountability, around acceptance of risk, around what people are willing to do and are able to do when they're faced with exceptional circumstances. As auditors, we're obviously very interested in governance and accountability, but I think what we've seen over the last period has been people being a bit more pragmatic about these things. And I guess we're hoping that as people look forward, they'll be able to have more agile decision making, and also that they'll be able to perhaps think a bit more differently about what risk appetite they want. A lot of times call for exceptional approaches. I think we want to keep the exceptionalism, but also have a degree of structure around things moving forward as well.
Thank you for your responses. I'm going to move to Megan Gallagher.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to all panel members of the Accounts Commission. I would like to ask a question more specifically on ALIOs. As councils and their ALIOs have been under financial strain for quite some time due to budget pressures, but also this has been exacerbated by the pandemic. We'd be interested to hear from the panel if they have carried out any research on the pandemic's impact of arm's length external organisations. For example, Glasgow Life, as we've seen, that jobs have sadly been cut and venues are set to close. I can imagine the devastating impact that this will have on local communities. This is just one example, but local authorities are now in a very difficult position, so we'd be interested to hear your views on this.
Thank you very much, Ms. Gallagher. And we haven't done a lot of detailed work, but it was one of the areas that we picked up in our most recent report, because we recognised the extent to which ALIOs depended on income to ensure their financial sustainability from one year to the next, as well as the grant funding that they would receive. But certainly the projected loss of income across ALIOs in 2021 projected was about £39 million, which is very significant. So there are a range of different ALIOs across Scotland, from the likes of Lothian Buses, Edinburgh Trams, to Glasgow Life, to a range of cultural and leisure facilities as well. I suppose we do plan to do more work on this. We are planning to undertake more review and audit work in relation to ALIOs, but one of the things I think is quite interesting is if we look at some of the services that are provided by ALIOs, they can be about transport, they can be about culture, they can be about leisure, and how do we view those in terms of the overall approach to economic recovery and also health and well-being in local communities. And I think our view is that we would be looking to see in the coming years and months more of a holistic view of all of these services to ensure that those communities that most need them and most rely on them would not be those that actually receive less of them in the future. Anthony, did you want to add anything to that?
Maybe to let the committee know that we're obviously in the process of auditing local authorities' accounts at the moment for this year's set of financial statements. And as part of that process, we'll be looking at the issue of ALIOs and how they feature in. We know there are many local authorities that have been issuing letters of comfort to ALIOs to tide them over the financial disturbance that they're experiencing at the moment. And many other local authorities have given additional funding to ALIOs to make sure that they can sustain themselves through what is a transition period as we move through the pandemic. It's quite likely, I think, that the next year's local government overview will pass some comment on the role that ALIOs play, not just in terms of the period that we're going through, but also in the longer term, the issues that Alma talked about in terms of the contribution they can make to social wellbeing and economic growth as well. So it's something we'll be reporting on in the future, and we'll be happy to speak to the committee once we've done that work.
Thank you for your responses. And yeah, we look forward to hearing the outcomes of that work that you're going to be doing. I'm going to move to Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Convener. We've touched on this issue already. The MMRE covered some of this in an opening statement. Just wanted to ask about how certain communities, how certain sections of society have been impacted more greatly by the pandemic. And you talked about women, ethnic minority communities. Just to ask beyond that, if there are any particular sections of society or communities that have been impacted greatest, and what evidence you see of local authorities directing resources, directing funding to support those areas in particular, rather than sometimes going to the areas or communities that shout loudest.
Thank you for your question, Mr. Griffin. So you're right. There have been, I suppose, there's a couple of points. There are specific groups of people that have been impacted. So if we take women, for example, women are in fact impacted in a number of ways, both in terms of many women are in low paid or vulnerable or fragile work situations. They also tend to adopt caring responsibilities within their families. And managing and juggling all of that has been particularly difficult and remains particularly difficult. Many women will have lost their jobs. I think as well, ethnic communities are also impacted significantly in relation to the type of work that they have as well, whether that work was local work, whether it was part of a large organisation. So again, we have heard anecdotal evidence of many people losing their job or not being able to be furloughed, for example. So that has been very extreme as well. I think it's important to remember that children and young people have had an incredible 18 months, and the mainstay of their kind of weeks, the structure of their weeks has been entirely upended as schooling was stopped. They had to work from home if they didn't have appropriate digital facilities or indeed a place to work, not even a table to sit and use a computer app, for example, then their schooling will have been significantly disrupted, and that could have a lasting impact for years to come. And young people and young adults looking for work as well have been significantly impacted as there has been very little work around. But the other aspect I think about all of this, and I think it's become much clearer through the pandemic, is the way all of these issues interrelate, and it then becomes almost personalised. So while a range of women may be affected in a particular way, depending on their ethnicity, depending on whether they've got caring responsibilities, what type of work they did, it becomes very, very personalised then. And that's where I think local governments got a good role to play in supporting those people, because they're closest to those communities and closest to the impact that has had, and who needs the support and the type of support that they need then to build a better future. So I'll pause there. I'm just wondering whether Anthony wants to add anything to that.
Obviously, the impact of the pandemic on young people and their education, which has been very badly disturbed, Elmer alluded to that. We know that the local authorities have done a great deal of work to try and address the challenges that, around people's mental health and wellbeing. And I think what we're seeing already in local authorities' recovery plans is an increasingly strong emphasis on that mental health dimension and the welfare dimension of the impact of COVID-19 on young learners. Carers obviously have been quite badly impacted during the pandemic as well. So that is a particular group where their caring responsibilities have often become more significant because of the challenges local authorities have had to provide caring support during the times of lockdown. And just made around the interconnectedness of these things. We are seeing, I think, at the moment, as local authorities turn their mind to longer term recovery planning, are they trying to draw these connections together? And I think there's real scope here for place-based planning and community engagement to play a really important part in helping to address those inequalities moving forward.
Thank you for those responses. I'm going to bring Eleanor Whittam in for a supplementary question and then an additional question.
Yeah, it's following on from Mark's question there. So I would like to ask the Commission, is there any evidence that you've seen of councils actually using their equality impact assessments to use a gendered lens to look at the decisions that they're making that actually affect women? So we know that women are by and large in precarious employment, as Elma outlined there, that are most affected sometimes by such decisions. So it's just to look back and over the last little while, are we seeing evidence that councils are taking that proactive approach?
So if one of my colleagues wants to come in, you can let me know and I'll bring you in. But we have not at this stage, as far as I'm aware, looked at equality impact assessments in explicitly that light. However, we are very focused on our role in terms of inequalities and how we can report more substantially on that. And we're also mindful of the forthcoming human rights legislation that the Parliament will be bringing forward in due course. So we are quite, I guess what I'm saying to you is that I would expect to see more of that in future work and certainly in terms of how we are taking forward our audit work, we're planning to do a lot more in inequalities. And just seeing my colleague Carol Calder might be able to say a few more words about that. Oh, Anthony wants to come in first, I think.
Thanks, Emma. I was just going to make the point that we've been thinking very hard about how we embed equalities across our audit work. And we're very conscious that the changing legislation means that we probably need to adopt a human rights-based approach to our work. We've done quite a lot of thinking about this, and it's obviously not straightforward and not easy things to do, and we don't want to do it in a mechanical way. But we will, I think, anticipate looking more closely at things like equality impact assessments. And also the processes through which local authorities is. Hand over to Carol now, because I think she wanted to say more on this.
Thank you, Anthony. I was just going to add that our next local government overview report for 2022, as Alma mentioned, we produce two each year. The focus on that will be very much on the recovery plans that councils have in place and the progress that's being made. And not only will inequalities be one of the big themes for that we'll be looking at to see how councils have progressed that, whether it be through the lens of women or other disadvantaged groups, we'll also be looking at how that all links to their economic redevelopment and also climate change as well. So we will be trying to pull in all of those links to see how that is affecting and improving circumstances for people in local areas. And the one thing that we'll be specifically looking for is that the response has been targeted, that councils have good independent evidence to know what the issues are in which communities in their area, and they've taken a targeted approach to that. So I think that you'll see in our next report more focus on that. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. And I'll move on to my other question. So I would like to know the Commission's view generally on mainstreaming of participatory budgeting and community empowerment. And also, what are the risks of transparency, accountability and resourcing of these really important work streams and policy areas?
Oh, thank you, Ms. Whittam. That's a big question. we've seen that councils are taking steps towards participatory budgeting. Well, more than steps, some have actually advanced it quite a bit, and it is something that they do now as a matter of course. So they've built that into the way in which they work with communities. Our best value reports, which we produce for each council on a five-year basis, and look at this in quite a bit of detail as well. So we've got quite a bit of evidence now about how councils are doing that. They don't do it all the same way, and that's okay, because every local authority area is different and they work with their communities in slightly different ways, but they are all advancing this. Can they do more? Absolutely. What we have seen through the pandemic has been more empowerment of communities and more support for communities, as councils have removed some of the bureaucracy that had been in place before in terms of letting communities step forward and do some work themselves. We do think that there's scope for that to grow and for that to be more widespread across Scotland. So that's something that we will be continuing to look at in our future audit work as well. In terms of transparency and governance, that's not been an issue that we have identified as a problem in the approach that as councils have taken this forward so far. And I don't know if that's because councils are just, you know, really getting into it and they're being quite careful about their approach. So it might be an issue for us to consider as it becomes more commonplace and widespread, so that we can make sure that it's being taken forward in a clear and transparent way. But that's a good addition to that question. I don't know whether Anthony wants to add anything to that.
The only thing I'd add, Elmer, if you don't mind, is to say I don't think for us the issue is to do with transparency. It's more to do with visibility and impact, because Alma says this is an agenda that local authorities have been taking forward for some time now. I think COVID-19 has shown that there's scope to increase the pace and increase the scale of this type of activity. And therefore, I think if that does happen, we might expect to see greater impact and visibility of this work. It's sometimes felt that it's happening alongside rather than planning and delivery of services. I think we'd like to see this being a bit more of a mainstream activity moving forward, and perhaps have better evidence of what difference it's really making on the ground. I'm sure it is making a difference on the ground. Now, the communities that are involved will probably be saying that they're getting a lot out of this. It is probably improving the life chances and outcomes for individuals that are involved. But there's something about making that more visible and sharing the good practice that feels like there's more to do on. So thank you.
Thank you for that. And I hope that in our role as a committee, we can help to make this participatory budgeting benefits more visible too. I'd like to move on to Paul McClellan.
Yes, thank you, Convener, and welcome, Chair, and members of the committee today. This is round about as we recover economically from COVID. Council's abilities to support the recovery are key. So services such as economic development, planning, environmental health are fundamental in that objective. Can you comment on spend levels on these across Scotland? You know, is there divergences also, and what impact, if any, is this having on economic recovery?
Thank you, Mr. McLean, for that question. I think it's fair to say that there will be differences across Scotland. Local councils will take different approaches to all of this work, depending on the needs, the range of businesses, the type of support that's required across their local area, and the resources that they have to put into that will be quite different from one part of Scotland to another. In our local government overview report published last year, we actually published it at the end of June because we delayed it a wee bit with the onset of the pandemic. We did a service case study specifically on planning services. And we commented at that stage. Now, the audit work for that is now nearly 2 years old, but we commented at that stage on the fact that planning had new responsibilities, but budgets had been reducing, that there were important roles in terms of leadership and partnership working for planning officers and planning councils, that there was a range of issues around workforce planning and encouraging new officers to come into planning, and also the importance of planning in terms of regeneration and the concepts around making good places for people to live in the country. if you want to know more about that, I would probably need to defer to my colleague Carol Calder, but that's an overview. In terms of economic development, though, we've seen some really interesting developments, and the Cabinet Secretary referred to some of them earlier on today around community wealth building. I'm quite familiar with some of that from the time that I spent previously in North Ayrshire Council, and I've kept an eye on how that's developing. And that's something that is definitely of interest to the Commission, and one of the areas that the Commission's interested in is a more inclusive approach to economic recovery and economic development, and one which has a local focus, but also starts to look at some of the issues surrounding inequalities as well, because none of these things are unrelated. So I hope that gives you a flavour overall of where the Commission's coming from, Mr McLellan, but I'll pass to Anthony, and I don't know, Anthony, whether we maybe want to let Carol say a few words about planning as well.
Certainly. I think it's fair to say that services like planning and economic development and other services like that have been put under greater pressure over recent years because of the emphasis and the focus on protecting services like education and health and social care. I think we have documented financial pressures and budget reductions. So that's just a statement of fact, I think, from the analysis that we've done hitherto. I think we're very keen, I think, to focus on the role that planning and economic development can play in terms of COVID recovery and renewal. And the Accounts Commission is committed to featuring that in its future work programme. We have previously reported on things like city deals that have been a very important bit of supporting economic growth. We have reported in the past on the role of local economic development departments in local authorities as well, but now feels like a good time for us to step back and think in this new context, particularly as we think about the new national planning framework and the new challenges that COVID-19 is presenting, what role does local authorities play? So you can expect that to feature in the Accounts Commission's work programme moving forward. I'm going to hand over to Carol now, though, if that's okay.
Thank you, Anthony. Yes, as Alma said, we did some work on planning in 2019 and reported it in 2020, so it's a wee bit out of date and it's obviously pre-COVID. But we had a discussion groups with stakeholders across the sector about what the issues were in planning departments across Scotland. And one of the really fundamental things that came out were the reduction in budgets over the last few years, and the focus on planning has moved to regulatory function as opposed to the wider delivering outcomes and sustainable environment and sustainable economic growth. What I would say, though, is there is enormous appetite amongst those planners to actually be involved in that, so that the Act itself and the new powers and the new refocusing of what planning is about is very much welcomed. But there has been significant issues around resourcing, significant issues around recruitment. There are only 100 planners per year approximately that graduate, and many of those go into the private sector, and 35% of the current workforce in local authorities are over the age of 50. So there is a difficulty to get planners in, but there is a tremendous appetite to move from that focus on regulatory function of planning to that wider outcomes-based, community-empowered-based approach.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. It's good to hear that. I think we're all kind of very encouraged by the idea that we move to this wider outcomes community empowerment approach. I'd like to move to Miles Briggs for the next question.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the whole panel from the Accounts Commission. Ms Calder actually just touched upon the question I wanted to ask, and it was specifically with regards to any analysis which you've conducted around local government workforce issues, and you've already outlined the challenge which planning departments across the country are seeing. So I suppose my key question I wanted to ask was, what assessment have you made pre-pandemic and post-pandemic about workforce challenges facing local government?
Thank you for that, Mr Briggs. So every best value audit report that we undertake, and as I say, we do one of these for a council on a five-year basis, and we look at the workforce challenges and we comment on the extent to which they have workforce plans in place. Our view is that, based on that research so far, is that more workforce planning needs to be undertaken. Now, that was our view before we went into COVID-19. It's still the same, that there is more work to be done. There are different challenges in different parts of the country, though. So you will go to some parts of the country and they will have workforce planning challenges around teachers, for example, and getting teaching resources, and you will go to another part of the country and that will not be a specific concern in that part of the country. You will go to some places and you will find it very difficult to get environmental health officers or planning officers, and in other parts of the country that might be a little easier. It's quite different from one part of the country to another. What we do ask for, though, is that councils look at what the needs are and start to plan out from that over a sort of medium term basis. I'm going to pause there. I don't know whether one of my colleagues feels that they would like to come in. I don't know whether that's something that one of the other Cantony.
Yeah. I was just going to make the point that we haven't done national analysis of workforce pressures across local government per se. But as Elma says, it's something we look at as an individual. Is it under pressure consistently? Social care is obviously an area that we know there are potential pressures. And also we've reported in the past about the difficulties that local authorities have experienced because of the competitive market around digital as well. But I think it is one of the areas we want to look at more carefully as we think about planning for recovery. Because when we've written reports before on workforce planning at Scottish Government level, I think that's proved to be a useful exercise to identify opportunities and challenges. So it's maybe something we want to think about as we plan our audit work on planning for recovery and renewal. That's one for us to think about, I think.
Thank you for that. Is it fair to say that there's a disconnect between the workforce we need in local government and what our university and college sector are then producing? And I was struck by the comments Ms. Calder made with regards to 100 planners, obviously qualifying for both public and private sector in Scotland, and the workforce, 35% of the workforce being over 50. Is that something you've looked at in terms of what we actually need in the future? And is, you know, it seems to be we in the NHS as well, we haven't got that national workforce planning right. Even though we know that people are heading towards retirement.
Yeah, I think those are helpful observations, Mr. Briggs, about some of the issues that are facing local government and indeed the health service as well. One of the other things that occurred to me while Anthony was updating you was that we also saw during the pandemic council workforces impacted specifically by the pandemic, either through kind of large numbers of their staff having to shield so they couldn't then work, or indeed being impacted by the virus itself and becoming ill. So whatever is happening in a local authority area to their overall population is quite likely to be happening for that council in terms of its workforce planning as well and its current workforce, because councils recruit to a large extent from their local area. Now that will be, well, if you go to the island communities, for example, it'll be pretty much 100% from their local area. But even across parts of Scotland, it's quite strongly that local authority area as well. So we haven't done that detailed work as my colleague Anthony said. We are planning to do more work. One of my colleagues, Blythe, has just reminded me to say that we do have it in scope for our local government overview, which will be produced next year in 2022. So it is something that is coming forward. But we do encourage councils always to look at medium-term workforce planning as a minimum.
Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thank you for that. And I'd like to go to Willie Coffey.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Elma. I wanted to ask you your thoughts on the work you plan to do in following the pandemic pound and just what the scope of that work may actually be. And in particular, to ask you, will you look at the systems that we used, the processes we used to distribute support to businesses, communities, individuals and so on? Because I'm sure other members around the table during the pandemic heard stories about how difficult it was for a number of organisations and businesses to access support. So will you look at that? Was it flexible enough? Did we get it right? Did everyone who needed help get help? So I'd be interested in what your thoughts are about that work that you plan to take forward.
Thanks very much for that question, Mr. Coffey. And we're still doing some work on, or still determining exactly what all of that work will look like. But you're absolutely right. One of the key areas that we will be looking at will be the way in which funding was distributed. We've already had a number of discussions as a commission about the distribution of grants to businesses and local groups, etc., and how that worked in practice. We will be having a look at how that has developed, but we'll also be looking at how councils received their money as well. I don't know whether my colleague Brian Howarth maybe wants to say a few words about this. Brian?
Yes, thank you very much. I mean, as well as coming to this committee with this report, I'm also an auditor to 5 councils and 5 IGBs across Scotland. And part of our local audit work this year has been responding to the differences that happened this year during COVID. So as part of that normal annual audit work, we've been looking at the controls, for example, that were put in place, existed over the additional funds which were administered by councils. You know, a lot of the business grants money that went out of councils to individual businesses. So we have been looking at in terms of controls over those disbursement of funds. We also we participate in a national fraud initiative as well, and these additional fund flows under the grants that have been made for COVID are part of that. So, you know, we're also aware of the kind of elements within that grants which might present additional fraud risk, and are looking at the detail of some of that.
Anthony's got a few words that he can add as well, a few thoughts that he can add to this as well.
Thank you.
Thanks, Emma. And thank you for the question, Mr. Coffey. It's a very important question. There's also been significant amounts of funding allocated to support COVID-19 response and recovery work, not just in local government, but in health and in the enterprise agencies as well. But our strategy really in this area is multifaceted. We are gathering information to understand the flows of funding that came from the UK government to the Scottish government. We're then analysing how those funding flows went from the Scottish government to the various agencies and to local authorities as well. So that's one specific piece of work that we'll be doing, and we'll be preparing that report next spring. In advance of that, we've been doing periodic updates of how the money has developed over time, and the next COVID-19 tracker is going to be published probably, I think, later in September, and that will update the Scottish Parliament on the way in which the funding has shifted in year, because obviously the Scottish Government has had to make quite important decisions at different points of the year outside the normal budget cycle. So that'll be an important piece of work for us to do. I think Brian mentioned this will be covered in next year's local government overview. We'll be also covering this in NHS overview reporting as well. Another specific piece of work, which I think is probably of interest to your question, which is looking at the way in which the Scottish Government supported the economic response to the COVID-19 pandemic, which will include coverage of how the business support grants were allocated and spent. And that would probably involve doing some analysis of variability of the use of those business support grants in different local authority areas. At the heart of this, we do want to learn lessons. I mean, this was an exceptional set of circumstances, but if there are things we can learn about how we might do this better or differently in future times, we'll be trying to do that as part of the audit work. So I hope that's a helpful addition to what my colleagues have said.
Yes, of course. Thank you, all three of you, for that response. Just finally, from me back to Elma. Elma, you said in your own comments that we don't want to return to the way things were, and everybody says that. We're hearing that right across the board. How realistic is that hope, do you think, that local government and other agencies don't return to the way things were, and that we embrace some of the new opportunities that came our way, particularly with the digital technology, to really change the way we do things in Scotland in the future?
Thanks, Mr. Coffey. Yes, I'm quite optimistic that can happen. I'm optimistic because I do see that from our discussions and our work with local government, we do see that they can see the benefits and the outcomes that local people have received as a result or achieved as a result of this of a different way of working. I'm also we also can see already that in terms of council's recovery plans and renewal plans, they are looking at how they transform, building on the work that they've already done. So their recovery plans are now part and parcel of their transformation plans as well. So trying to build on what they've done better as a result of the pandemic. And it sounds awful to talk about anything being better from something as horrendous as the pandemic, but there are some things that people have done which are improved and they want to build on that. I think as well though, there's a real issue of leadership, both political leadership and officer leadership, both in councils and at the parliament, and for that encouraging environment to be developed. So one of the things that I have seen through my career, so a wee bit of reflection here from me as well as from what I've seen since I've been working with the Accounts Commission and Audit Scotland, is that it's sometimes hard for councils and for councils to do new things because the risk if they get it wrong can be quite substantial. Sometimes we're not very kind to councils when they don't quite get things right. So there is something around that leadership and holding true to doing things in a different way, learning from mistakes and recovering quickly on the back of that. And certainly in the Accounts Commission and Audit Scotland, we are also very, very keen that we want to see councils trying to do the right things, and we are open to the potential for making mistakes, learning and moving on. And if we can see that that's happening, then that's something we would be very encouraging of.
That's really helpful. Thank you. Back to you, convener.
Thank you. And I would like to ask Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, convener. I would like to pick up on the issues being faced by integration joint boards, and in particular the financial pressures. I believe it's the majority of IJB boards are struggling to achieve break-even, and they're also facing issues in relation to instability of leadership. So it's to ask for more information on the Commission's assessment of the funding, financial planning and performance of integration joint boards.
Thank you very much, Ms Gallagher. Another a great question. Yes, so we have reported now in successive years around the financial difficulties that are being faced by IJBs and also the leadership challenges. We have not seen a change in that over the pandemic. They continue to have financial and challenges. And when I say leadership challenges, that's not to say that they're not trying to show leadership. It's really about just the very specific issues around getting chief officers in place and actually for them to stay with that IGB over a period of time to allow them to get a bit of traction and direction for the IGBs. What I was going to bring up, though, is that the Commission is about to start a significant piece of work which will commence next autumn with when we go into a new audit period, a new 5-year audit period. Just so you know, our current audit period has actually been 6 years because we've extended it by a year because of the pandemic. But we will start a new 5-year audit period next year. And as part of that, we intend to start to do best value audit reports on IGBs, and we've already started to pilot some of that work with IGBs as well. Again, this is about trying to be supportive in terms of improvement, but also highlighting the key issues that need to be addressed. Now, I would hope that those would be matters that we could bring to some of the other committees within the Parliament, but obviously we can bring some of those issues to your committee as well, because they can't really be separated from certainly local government and housing matters for that in terms of what IGBs are doing. So we will start that work next year formally. We've also undertaken quite a bit of work in working with Health Improvement Scotland, who have a role in this as well, and trying to take a very joined up approach to our auditing and of IGBs, so that it's a very much a holistic picture that's going to come forward. I think that kind of summarises the position from my perspective. Anthony, you've been leading a lot of this work along with us. I don't know if you want to add anything to what I've said.
I think the context for this is quite important. And if we think about the recent Feely report and the thinking that's going on around how we might need to transform adult social care and other aspects of social care to well-known demographic pressures that IJBs have faced for some time. So we have reported about the challenges IJBs face financially, but I think there's also something for me which is about the challenges they face in terms of managing change with NHS territorial boards and local authorities. And that's a difficult job. You know, you're trying to manage change across a number of organisations. The levers that IJBs have available to themselves are to an extent constrained by the legislation. I think there are some quite important questions as we look to the future about how we find a way of working that allows the outcomes to be improved in the way that the Feely report highlighted, but also address the long-term financial pressures that these bodies face. As Elma said, when we talk about leadership challenges, I don't think we're criticising the leadership of individual IJBs. It's just that we've seen quite a lot of churn and turnover at IJB chief officer level. It's a difficult job. It's a difficult job. This is very much on our radar, as Elma said, and we will look forward to reporting that to this committee and others on the outcomes of our work.
Thank you for that. I have a question. So many councils have declared climate emergencies and have climate officers or teams in place. And I wondered if the Commission intends to assess the extent to which councils are contributing to Scotland's net zero ambitions.
Thank you, Convener, for that question. And that is work that we do intend to be taking forward. It is something that we've been very interested in, and we've highlighted it as part of our best value audit reports whenever we do one of those on a council. So the most recent one from Aberdeen highlighted some of the work that they've been doing there, and also Aberdeenshire last year, some of the innovative work that they've been doing there. And we do that to try and let other councils see what else is going on. We are planning to do some climate change work, certainly before we get to November. So we would hope to have a short publication that we can bring out just a wee bit later this year. I don't know whether anyone of the team wants to say anything.
Yeah.
Anthony?
Thank you very much. This is a very timely question. I think we probably have to acknowledge that we've come a little bit late to the climate change. I was going to say party. Party's not the right term, but the climate change emergency and a policy area. It isn't an area that's featured heavily in our audit work in the past, apart from when we've done best value audits on individual local authorities. We're very clear that this is one of the biggest issues facing the world at the moment, and it has to be given significant prominence and coverage in our audit work. As Elma said, we had a round table recently where we brought together a range of stakeholders from community groups, academics, the Climate Change Committee from the UK, to talk about what the nature of the climate change challenges are facing Scotland, and also to ask them how audit can help. And we think there's a really important role for public audit to highlight the performance of individual public bodies in terms of discharging their climate change duties, promoting transparent reporting around climate change spending, and also CO2 emissions within public bodies. And we also think there's probably scope for us to do a bit of work with other parties to highlight what good practice we're seeing emerging. So you can expect this to feature quite heavily in our work programme in the coming months and years. The document Elma mentioned a few moments ago will be a first, if you like, a step for us to say these are the likely themes of our work. We want to spend a bit more time putting a bit more flesh on the bones of where we think we can really add most value. And the formal audit work probably won't start until early-ish in 2022, but it's very much part of our thinking at the moment. If I might just say a little bit more, we think there's probably scope to do this and at national level as well, because I think we audit all the public bodies in Scotland. So there, for us, there's something about using that audit work at local level and at national level to maximise the value of the audit work that we do in this area. But it is going to be increasingly embedded in all the work we do. Thank you.
Thank you for that response. It's good to hear that you are planning to take on the work. I'm certainly talking to various climate officers in councils across the country. I think they, you know, feel like, you know, they need some feedback on, you know, what they're doing and the impact they're having. So I think it would be a very important piece to do, and also heartened to hear the idea of a national scope as well. We've got time for one more question, and I'm going to give that to Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to ask what the Commission's understanding is with regards to the local governance review and how that's progressing, and what views you had with regards to the fiscal framework which would be developed between the Scottish Government and local governments, and how that would actually work.
Thanks very much, Mr. Briggs. I think the local governance review, in terms of how it works with local government, is a matter for local government. I think our view would be that if it's encouraging better outcomes for communities, for individuals and communities, then that would be the ideal position. That would always be where we would want to see the results coming, if you like. I did want to touch on the fiscal. I would want to say a couple of words about the fiscal framework, though, because the Accounts Commission, from before I was even involved in working with the Accounts Commission and Northern Scotland, have been saying consistently that the funding and the financial position for local government has not been great. They have had a significant period of time where they had reductions in funding, and it's only in the last year to 2 years where they have increases. And last year, most of those increases were one-offs. The large proportion were one-offs to deal with the pandemic. COSLA, and I'm not here to argue a case for COSLA, absolutely not, but COSLA have put some proposals into the government in terms of what a fiscal framework might look like. I do think there needs to be more serious discussion about trying to improve the fiscal position, because Council's budgeting from year to year, bidding for funds, etc., just detracts from the day job of getting on with delivering better outcomes for communities and tackling some of the very significant inequalities that we've already discussed in this session today with this committee. So they have raised issues around council tax and having more flexibility, local flexibility around council tax, around having more discretionary taxation powers, and also having a kind of degree of certainty around their funding settlement. And I thought the Cabinet Secretary's comments on this were quite interesting earlier on about the settlement position. I suppose my view and the view of the Commission is that because of what happens between Scottish Government and UK Government happens in a certain way, that doesn't mean to say that needs to be translated down to the relationship between local government and Scottish Government as well. And I think certainly with my history in local government, we've had a long, long time talking about a different kind of financial model or fiscal settlement for local government. And we need to collectively do better to reach some agreement.
Thanks very much.
Thank you very much for all your answers to the questions. It's been very, very helpful in this evidence session this morning to hear your views, and we look forward to working with you over the course of the session. The committee has agreed to consider agenda items 4 and 5 in private, and as such, the committee will now move into private for the remainder of the meeting, and I close this public part of the meeting.